So we are on the YouTube, and I would like to thank you very much for being willing to talk to me. So we just have a talk starting, of course, with the tradition of where do you come from?
All right. Well, thank you for having me once again. This has been an interesting and valuable journey for me thus far. So I'm very happy to be here. I am from South Africa, of course, and specifically from a town in the Western Cape by the name of George. So George is pretty much in the middle of an area in the Western Cape that's referred to as the Garden Route. And I would regard the Garden Route as the most beautiful part of South Africa. I might be biased, but we have beautiful beaches and beautiful mountains. So I'm from George. It's referred to as a city, but I think it's more like a big town.
Great. Nice. Yeah. Sounds splendid.
Yes.
The first meeting we had, I was totally shocked by your name, because Gretchen Jansen is the most terrific German sounding name I've ever heard. Where does the name come from?
Okay, so my mother has some German ancestry. She is originally from Namibia. And as you know, Namibia used to be a German colony way back when it was still called Southwest Africa. And so, yeah, my mother's grandfather was part of the military and ended up in Southwest Africa. And he stayed there and started a family. And so that was my grandfather's father. And that's where I came from. So, yeah, we do have some, I have some German ancestry, some German lineage. And that's pretty much where my German name comes from.
Okay. I see. But your family has a 30 years of tradition of having lawyers.
Sorry?
You have 300 years of having lawyers involved in the family.
No, I'm the first lawyer in the family.
Yeah.
We have quite a few teachers. So I regard my work as a lecturer as sort of still serving that tradition of having teachers in the family. But I'm the first one in the family to have studied law.
So why law?
That is a good question. I think the common things that people say, if you want to be successful, you need to be either a doctor or a lawyer. And I am not great with numbers. Either a doctor or a lawyer and an engineer. I'm not great with numbers. Engineering wasn't going to work. I'm a little squeamish. I don't like blood and gore. So I don't think medicine was going to work either. So I picked law.
That's a good decision, nevertheless.
Yes, I don't regret it at all.
So you went to school in George?
Yes, so I went to an Afrikaans high school in George by the name of Otanikwa High School, quite a well-known high school in South Africa. We've had a couple of well-known alumnus, not me included. I went to school in George.
Yeah, let's wait in the future.
We'll see.
So, how can I think of an education in George? How long did you go to high school?
Okay, so the South African schooling system is 12 years. So you have grade 1 to grade 7, 7 years in primary school. And then you go to high school for 5 years.
Oh, yeah.
So it's basically those two. And I am actually Afrikaans speaking. So I went to an Afrikaans school. And yeah, because I think because George is smaller, it has quite a good schooling system because the town as a whole is more family focused. So good for raising children.
Okay, that sounds good. We say in Germany that somebody wants to study law, it needs to be good in language and mathematics. So how is the situation with you?
Yeah, so as I said, I'm not great with numbers. I was able to get through school with mathematics, but yeah, I definitely have a love for languages. I enjoy reading and I enjoy writing as well. And that was one of the main reasons why I ended up choosing to study law, because I have quite an affinity for language and literature.
And for music.
Yes, of course. Music is my first love.
Yeah. Did you do a lot of singing?
Yes. So I've sang in choirs pretty much my whole life. Starting from primary school, I think grade one, I might have already started singing in a choir. And I sang all the way through high school. Took a bit of a break in my first year of university. And then at the end of my first year, I auditioned for the Stellenbosch University choir, which is quite well known. We've been at the top of the rankings at the World Choir Games for quite a few years now. So I consider myself an Olympian, you can say.
Yeah.
Because I was in the choir when we took part in the World Choir Games in 2016 in Sochi in Russia.
Wow.
So yeah, so choir then became quite a big part of my life during university as well. And then after I finished my studies, I sort of dropped off because it was difficult to find, firstly, the time, of course, once you start working. And yeah, there was just sort of a bit of a lull in where I could find exposure to choir music again. And then through having been in the university choir, I got to know a couple of people that from the university choir started sort of an offspring choir for young professionals. So I'm currently also singing in a choir.
Wow.
And yeah, so we're based in Durbanville, which is a suburb in Cape Town. And yeah, most of us used to sing in the university choir. Some people sang in other choirs throughout their lives, but it's sort of just a hobby that we try to keep going because we all have quite the passion for choral singing.
And why Stellenbosch?
That is another good question. Well, the first thing would be that Stellenbosch is the closest university to my home. And I'm quite family orientated. I don't want to be too far away from my parents and my siblings. So that was the first consideration. It was the closest distance wise. And yeah, our high school was sort of a feeding school for Stellenbosch University. I think a very big chunk of our graduates end up going to Stellenbosch University. So it was sort of a natural progression of things to move from my high school in George to Stellenbosch University.
How is the value of Stellenbosch ranked in the South African education system? Is it a high value, number one university, or?
I don't know if I'm the right person to ask. I might have a biased opinion. But no, I think Stellenbosch is doing quite well for itself. I think the university has fantastic outputs in terms of research and innovation. And I myself can attest to the massive strides in transformation that the university is trying to make to sort of meet the societal needs of what is required of a higher education institution. So yes, I think we are doing quite well for ourselves. Of course, I don't really believe in the sort of rankings of higher education institutions because those rankings are determined based on very specific criterion. And depending on what the university's mission and vision are, it might it will affect how it ranks in those criteria. So yeah, I don't really believe in those actual published rankings of universities, but I think Stellenbosch is definitely one of the best universities in South Africa.
And do you remember your first day in Stellenbosch?
Oh, yes, of course. Well, a big part, at least for me, of going to university, aside from the studies, is that we, many first year or younger students, live in what we call residences, which is basically like big houses that students get put into, and you live with a big group of women in a house. And that becomes quite a big part of your sort of cultural time at the university. Mm-hmm. So yeah, when I moved to Stellenbosch, moving into my residence was sort of the most overwhelming part. Because it was my first time that I was going to live somewhere that was not with my parents. But I had very good experiences in my residence, and I think it's also a nice, safe environment to make friends, because everyone is there on their own for the first time. So yes, that's definitely the first thing I remember of my, when I arrived in Stellenbosch, because it was quite scary. And the other thing I remember is that it was very, very hot. Like at the end of January, it was like 45 degrees or something.
Whoa.
Yes, and the town was teeming with scared teenagers and their parents. So yeah, those are my two main memories on my first day, is being nervous and scared to move into the residence and sweating.
And what about the professors?
Our faculty is one of the smaller faculties at the university. I think we are actually the second, we might be the second smallest faculty at the university, apart from theology. So that means that it's a bit more intimate in terms of you get to meet and interact with more professors earlier. So I think that was nice. It wasn't as overwhelming, I think, for a first-time student to go into that space, because it is more personal and more intimate. I honestly can't say that I had any bad experiences or anything like that. It was all positive experiences, definitely.
And I hope you answer my question correct, because what is your favorite topic in law? Is it civil law? Is it public law or criminal law?
It's definitely civil law. Yeah, so the department I work in at the moment, we refer to it as mercantile law, which I think speaks to sort of the commercial nature of the subjects we focus on.
Yeah,
that's definitely my main focus. And you've already alluded to my love for music. So if we're being more specific, my favorite part of the law is, of course, intellectual property law.
Yeah.
And I think a big part of that is my love for the arts and anything creative, which is just something that I've always had. Yeah. I don't know where it comes from. So when I learned about intellectual property law, I realized it was the perfect sort of convergence of the two main things in my life, which is, of course,
so you attended immediately to the courses of Zadula Kajika and listened to every word he's saying.
Yes. And of course, you know Sadullah, and he has quite an interesting reputation for being a bit of a character in the faculty. And that made it so much more interesting to listen to this man that has this big reputation.
Mm.
Yeah.
So 3 years of study, yeah?
No, so our undergraduate degree is 4 years. And then after that, I did my master's in intellectual property law, which was 1 year. And then I took a bit of a break, and then I registered for my PhD in intellectual property law.
Tell me more about the effects of a PhD. What is the value of PhD studies?
Okay, so for me specifically, because I am pursuing a career in academia specifically, and what that means generally, specific also in law particularly, is getting a doctoral degree, of course, to get promoted at the university, move up in your positions as a lecturer and a teacher, and of course solidifying yourself as an expert in the field that you are researching.
We have discussed the matter. There is no habilitation as we have in Germany, so you become immediately a professor after having written a PhD.
No. So you'll then be a doctor. So your title will be doctor. Yeah. And then I think this sort of the criterion to become a professor depends on the specific department and the specific university that you're at. But then there are additional things that you need to do to sort of prove that you are really an expert at that level in your field of research. And only then will you get the title of professor. So it is still quite a bit after you've completed your doctoral studies, yeah.
Do you know the name Reinhard Zimmermann?
No, should I?
He was a professor, I think, in Pretoria. No. He was a guy, a German law professor who went to South Africa, and he was teaching at Pretoria for 10 years. He has written a marvelous book on law of obligations, which showed that all the European acts and statutes and civil laws are based on a kind of common notion of Roman law.
Yes.
So that was a short introduction to the famous, overwhelming Reinhard Zimmermann. But what do you think, is South African law special in combining Roman law and common law?
Yeah, so South African law is based in a Roman Dutch tradition. So it also depends on which parts of the law. So for example, in intellectual property law, our intellectual property law is very heavily based in the British common law, or rather the British intellectual property law. So we don't have a common law for intellectual property, meaning our IP is a creature of statute. So if there's not something that provides for it in legislation, then it doesn't exist, basically, because there isn't any common law rules to fall back on. So yeah, I think the fact that South Africa sort of has a bit of a combination of the two is quite interesting. And that, of course, is because of our an interesting history of the country. Yeah.
I understand. So and now is your time, the 5 minutes, to talk about your PhD. What are you dealing in the PhD?
Okay, so once again, I have a very deep love for music. I'm a musician myself. So musicians and their rights in terms of the law has always been something very near and dear to my heart. And so when it came to me trying to find a topic for my doctoral research, I looked into music copyright and musicians' rights. So then based on sort of what's happening right now in terms of technological developments as well, I sort of narrowed down my topic to the royalty rights of performing artists.
Yeah.
So in South Africa, you have copyright, and then you also have performers' rights, which is sort of an ancillary or related right to copyright.
Yeah.
So I'm specifically looking at those related rights and specifically looking at how performers are remunerated for the use of their performances on sound recordings, musical sound recordings, in the use by radio stations and streaming platforms. So platforms like Spotify and Apple Music. And yeah, so I'm looking specifically at the remuneration rights, the royalty rights that we currently have, whether they are up to par with technological developments, whether they are being implemented effectively. And in the implementation, as you know, of course, with remuneration rights, we generally rely on collecting societies to administer those rights. So I'm also looking at the operation of collecting societies in South Africa, considering whether they are regulated effectively and whether they operate effectively to ensure that the musicians at the end of the day receive the remuneration that they are due.
But you have one disadvantage in South Africa. You have a totally outdated Copyright Act.
Yes, yes, we do. So our Copyright Act as well as our Performance Protection Act are both quite outdated. Technically, the last amendment was in 2013, but that was the Intellectual Property Laws Amendment Act, which is still quite contentious and has technically not been enforced at all. So prior to that, the Performance Protection Amendment or the Performance Protection Act, the last amendment was in 2002. So yeah, so both of these acts don't really speak to a lot of the technological developments that have taken place. And we are currently in quite a rigorous and long-winded process of copyright reform in our country. I think the bill has gone through, I don't even know how many, it could be 10 by now, iterations from 2015 up until now. There's another round of public commentary happening right now. I just got an invitation to a hearing that I won't be able to attend in South Africa next week. But yeah, so we are currently in the process of trying to update our copyright legislation to sort of speak to the changes in society and technology.
What is the problem with drafting a new Copyright Act in South Africa?
Well, the first thing, I think the major problem is that the people that are in charge of drafting the legislation aren't experts in the field. And while our Copyright Act provides for the creation of a advisory committee comprised of actual experts to assist in updating and promulgating new legislation, in this instance, that committee was not used at all. So that's the biggest issue, is that the legislation was drafted by non-experts. And then in South Africa, there are quite differing opinions as to how the legislation should be amended, coming from experts in the field. And I think that also makes it difficult for the drafters to decide what is the right way to go, because we have quite prominent voices that are disagreeing on what the right way is to do the amendments. And I think that has prolonged the process as well, because it's difficult to find a compromise or an agreement as to how the legislation should look.
Yeah.
I think that's what's taking so long.
But don't you use the expert in the committees?
So that's the problem. The advisory committee wasn't used. That's the main problem. I think it's at the outset, when the amendments started in 2015, the whole process started, the statutory advisory committee was not used.
Right.
Yeah.
Why not?
That's a good question.
And so we had a discussion, which I very much liked. There's a discussion on traditional law view of copyright law professors, liberal view, and constitutional view. How is the situation in South Africa? Is everybody stubborn, only looking towards conservative traditional copyright law, or other forces? How do you describe the discussion?
Yeah, so I think from you and from some of the other people that I've met while here in Germany, I think the situation is quite similar. So as I've said, I think especially now with this amendment process, a lot of those views have come to light. And like I said, prominent voices in the academic environment and in industry are differing quite fundamentally. So there's clear divides between certain people that have more traditional views on copyright and intellectual property protection, and then other people that have more liberal views and opting for more, comprehensive in-depth changes to the legislation. So yeah, I think the situation is very similar to Germany, where there's a clear divide in how people consider the law. And like I say, I think that is what's also confusing our legislature in terms of deciding what the best way forward is going to be in the amendment of our laws.
So that's one topic, music law. But I know you as well as one of the leading experts on art law. So tell me about the art law clinic.
I'll say I find it flattering that you say I'm a leading expert in art law. Well, first, I would regard myself a bigger appreciator of art than an expert in art law. But from that appreciation, of course, also stems an interest in the field of law. So yes, I am the coordinator in Stellenbosch for our newly created art law clinic. And we are in the process of registering the clinic as a society with the university, which means any student at Stellenbosch University will be able to join the society. And the main goal and aim of the art law clinic in Stellenbosch is to assist and provide guidance to our art students or artists in the Stellenbosch community on sort of basic art law, which includes, of course, intellectual property, basic contract law, even common law, like the law of delict or tort. So, yeah, sort of providing a basic but comprehensive guidance to artists in the community. I think especially our students, because they all leave the university and enter the workforce or the art environment in South Africa. So we are just trying to equip them with the most basic legal knowledge to ensure that they are protected and they know their rights, etc.
And sound good. Sounds really excellent, but I'm asking myself, what are you doing in Münster?
That is also a good question. I'm getting cold.
Sorry for that.
It's okay. Yeah, so first things, of course, that you, when you visited us in South Africa at Stellenbosch, spawned the idea of creating an art law clinic in Stellenbosch. And so my visit here, the purpose of my visit here is also to see how the Münster Art Law Clinic operates, especially since we are quite new in South Africa. So here I can see how a clinic that has been up and running for a while, how you operate, what you do, so I can learn from that and take some of those tips and tricks back home. And secondly, I'm here to learn. Just broadly speaking, I'm here to learn, seeing how German copyright law operates, learning from experts like yourself, speaking to industry experts as well, just getting sort of a feel of how music copyright operates in Germany. Of course, Germany has quite a strict, I would say, strict laws on remuneration, which I think is also something to look at, because like I say, my research specifically focuses on remuneration of performing artists. So yeah, I think there is a lot for me to learn while here.
So how is your impression of the ITM?
Oh, I might have to reserve comment. No, I'm having a wonderful time. All the researchers are very friendly and nice. And it's a very nice working environment, I would say. Very relaxed. No stress, which is great.
No, no stress.
good coffee breaks. Yeah, no, I think it's a good working environment. And it seems that everyone that is working here, everyone is quite passionate about the work that they do, which is very nice to see. And another thing that I noticed is because in Stellenbosch we are quite small, so I'm part of the Anton Mostert Chair of Intellectual Property Law in Stellenbosch, which is very, very small. And it's nice to come here and there are many people that I can speak to about my work and I don't have to over-explain myself because they already understand, understand what I'm talking about. So it's good to be around like-minded people and people that are passionate about the same things that I am. So no, it's all good.
Fine, that's fine. Now I'm coming to the most important question, to one. What would you recommend to a young lawyer who is thinking of starting a study in law? Forget about it, or
no. I think studying law is a good career to pursue. I'm trying to think what my best advice would be. First, I think would be to immerse yourself in your community as much as you can, to get a good understanding of people and how people think and why people think the way they do. I think that would be my biggest advice. Get to know people. Get to know people.
Yeah.
And I was going to say read, but I'm sure you will be doing enough reading throughout your studies.
Yeah,
so
sure.
I would say trying to get a good understanding of people in general and how they think and why they think the way they do, I think gives you a good background to your legal studies. Because at the end of the day, it's people work what we're doing at the end of the day. Yeah.
Second question. What really would you recommend when somebody asks you, what is this art law about? What can they do to understand what art law in practice means?
Well, the first thing I would say is they can follow our clinic on Instagram.
Okay.
Because the art law clinic is doing sort of snippet posts on some of the basic concepts in law, which I think is very helpful to someone that may have a question like that.
Yeah.
But yeah, otherwise I would say, as I've said to you now, in summary, basically, it's just art law is about providing, or our art law clinic is about providing the basics on law for artists, which includes their intellectual property rights, how contracts work, what are the main things to look out for when entering into a contract, things like that.
Okay. And now the question for the three books. Which three books would you recommend to read for young lawyers?
I'm the worst person to ask. I always say I'm the person that would say I love to read, but at the end of the day, I just like owning books.
Owning is much more easier than reading.
Than reading, exactly. Yes, I have no idea. I'm gonna lie if I try and come up with three books for you now on the top of my head. I think that has been the one thing. Maybe I'm just not good at managing it, but it's been the one thing I can truly see that I am reading much less for leisure because I'm reading so much for work. So when I have a moment to just relax, I tend to just listen to music or do something that's not reading. Which is bad because I actually quite enjoy reading. But yeah, so I'm not going to give an answer. That's my answer. I'm a bad reader at the moment.
But you never had a book which impressed you so much that you said, wow, I would recommend that book for reading.
Yo, I don't know. This is quite embarrassing, but I can't think of one right now.
of Sadula, perhaps.
No.
No, it's okay. So thank you very much for that lovely interview. I will now stop.